Hello, and welcome back to CS615 System Administration. This is week 5, segment 3, and following our analysis of the IPv4 packet and the concept of classless inter-domain routing or CIDR subnetting, it's time to now take a look at our big hero IPv6, coming to rescue us from IP exhaustion. So, to refresh our memory, let's look real quick at this illustration from a previous video, showing the structure of the IPv4 packet. We identified the various segments based on a single TCP packet captured using TCP dump while talking to the Steven CS web server. We had called out the 32-bit source and destination addresses and looked at how a subnet mask can be used to divide the address into a network and a host portion. So now, what does this look like when using IPv6? For that, we'd like to repeat the previous packet capture, only this time we'll make a request to a website that has an IPv6 address. Note that you do of course need to be on an IPv6 enabled system to repeat this exercise. Your home ISP may or may not offer you an IPv6 address, and your local Wi-Fi access point may not be configured to offer IPv6. Unfortunately, it's 2021 and Amazon still does not enable IPv6 by default on all your resources. But at least since 2017, you can actually get a native IPv6 address in AWS and don't need to use a tunnel broker, so hooray for progress. Anyway, so if you want to ensure your new AWS instances comes up with both IPv4 and IPv6 enabled, also known as being dual stack, you can follow the steps I outlined here in this blog post. With that, your instance should then get a routable IPv6 address, so we can then start our packet capture. Okay, so we again start out with TCP dump. This time looking for packet communicating with www.yahoo.com. We make our curl request as before. And then read the first packet we captured from the file. Now, the first few bytes are going to be the same, since this is on the data link layer using the same MAC address as we did before. But then the next field, describing the type of the protocol the MAC frame wraps, is no longer IP, but now the value for IPv6. The bytes starting after that, and going up to about here, are the IPv6 header, with the remainder as the TCP payload. Let's look at our IP addresses on the ZenNet0 interface, and what www.yahoo.com resolves to, so you can compare that output to what we find in the TCP dump packet. Okay, there we go. Now let's compare to what we did for IPv4. Here's the structure of the IPv6 header, which looks similar, but a bit simpler than the IPv4 header, don't you think? Let's look at the fields. First, we have a 4-bit version field, which is set to 6, no surprise. Next, we have the traffic class, which, similar to an IPv4, includes the DSCP and ECN bits, all 0 here. After that comes a 20-bit flow label. A flow is really just a group of packets that belong together, such as, say, a TCP session. By having this identifier, we can later more easily trace a full request across the network. Anyway, so this flow label is generated randomly, and the first 32 bits here are represented in the above 8 hex bytes. Next comes the payload length, 28 hex or 40 decimal, since we have no additional IPv6 headers here. Then we specify the protocol of the payload, TCP in this case, and add a hop limit, effectively the TTL we recall from the IPv4 header, with a default value of 64 just like in IPv4 as well. And that's really it. The remaining 256 bits are used for the source address and the destination address, highlighted here in the TCP dump output in hex. Okay, so Now, do we have to go back to the tedious task of converting these hex characters into an IP address as we did for IPv4? Take a look. Turns out, we don't. IPv4 addresses are in hex, so we see our actual IP address here, literally in the TCP dump packet, which is rather convenient. Now, let's again compare to IPv4. As we observed in our last video, IPv4 addresses are 32-bit numbers, and as we've seen, IPv6 addresses are a bit larger. Specifically, IPv6 addresses are 128-bit numbers. Why we ended up with 128 bits, and what problems IPv6 was intended to solve is something we'll cover in our next video, but for now let's focus merely on the structure of the address. And so having 128 bits makes for a rather unwieldy long address. If we used the dotted decimal notation, we'd end up with 16 octets. So instead, we use 8 16-bit fields that we convert to hex and separate by a colon, so that our really long bit string here becomes this hexadecimal string. But since strings like this can still be a bit large, we have a few ways of shortening them. For starters, any leading zeros can be left out. But in addition, if we have successive fields of zeros, then we can leave those out completely. But note that we can only do this once, meaning that if we had double zeros on the left and on the right, you have to decide which ones you want to compress. So for example, if you had an address like this, then you could either compress it like this, by eliding the two leftmost zero-bit fields. Or you can compress it like this, eliding the three rightmost zero-bit fields. But note that we cannot compress both sides, since now it's impossible to determine how many fields should be filled in on the left or right. But do note that either of these two compressions, right only or left only, are valid and represent the same address, as does the uncompressed version of the string. Okay, so in addition to the compression of the string, there are a few additional things you want to consider when it comes to written IPv6 addresses. Just like in IPv4, where we have 127.0.0.1 on the loopback device, we also have an IPv6 loopback address, ::1. Note that this is really not a special case at all, it is merely an address with 127 leading zero bits, translating to 7 words of all zeros, which we compressed. The bigger difference here is that the loopback device in IPv4 actually got an entire class A network, not just that one address, but we'll get back to that in a future video. If your system is dual stack configured, and your socket allows both IPv4 and IPv6 addresses, you may encounter so-called IPv4 mapped addresses, where the 32-bit IPv4 address in dotted decimal format is stuffed into an IPv6 address with a special prefix of all zeros, FFFF. Next, although not strictly part of the IP address, we have to consider how applications handle specifying a port in addition to an address. In IPv4, we use the :port notation to specify an IP address port pair. But since IPv6 addresses use the colon as a separator, we can't do that. For that reason, we use a new syntax, where we use brackets around the IPv6 address followed by a colon and the port. Finally, we need to point out that different IPv6 addresses have different implicit scopes. As you may have noticed when we looked at the output of ifconfig, we noticed that each interface has multiple addresses. So far, that's not unusual, as any interface can have multiple IPv4 addresses too. But in IPv6, each interface always has a so-called link local scope address. This link local address is generated on the host itself, without requiring any specific network knowledge or DHCP help or anything like that. It is an address within the FE80/10 network, with a low 64 bits generated using a standardized algorithm. This address is only used on this specific link, and any packets received or sent to or from this address are never forwarded to any other link, meaning you are guaranteed that the packets stay on the interface. Next, we have so-called unique local addresses in the FC00/7 network, which are used for private IPv6 networks and which are not globally routed. This is conceptually similar to the IPv4 RFC1918 IP space that you're familiar with from your local Wi-Fi network, your AWS default IPv4 space, etc. Lastly, we have the global addresses. These are the normal addresses you will see and use, such as the one we used in our examples here. They are globally unique and can be routed on the public internet. Now, as you can see from looking at these bullet points here, we frequently talk about network space in terms of slash notation, just like we did when we talked about IPv4 CIDR subnetting, and that's one of the things where IPv6 really is not that different from IPv4. We still use a bitmask called a subnet prefix here, and the slash notation still applies. The only difference here is that the number after the slash can be a lot larger, since we now have 128 bits to play with. So it should come as no surprise that we can use similar tools to calculate and inspect the different subnet prefixes. The IPCalc utility we used in our last video doesn't support IPv6, unfortunately, so we are using a different tool, SIPCalc. If we specify a /64 subnet length, then we get output like this, illustrating the expanded and compressed forms, as well as the subnet prefix, the address scope, and the network range, all looking rather similar to our previous IPv4 examples. If we wanted to increase our subnet, we'd use a smaller network prefix, say /48 here. And if we picked a /72 prefix, things would look like so. Note, however, that one of the most commonly encountered prefixes will be /64. Why that is something we'll cover in our next video. Alright, so now it's your turn to look around and explore the IPv6 world around you. Check if you get an IPv6 address, and if so, whether your normal network is IPv6 enabled. This can extend to common public networks or your home network. If your home network currently doesn't support IPv6, can you change that? What about our AWS instances? I already linked the blog post that describes how you can set up your environment to ensure your instances come up dual stack. If you haven't done so already, please do that now, as we'll be using dual stack networking in our next videos and exercises. Do some research and find out which popular services and systems are IPv6 enabled. You may assume that all the big players would be, but are they? Which services are not? Why do you think that is? In our next video then, we'll talk a bit about internet governance and discuss where IP addresses come from, how they are allocated, and why exactly we even need IPv6 at all. 32 bits should have been enough for this little experiment called the internet, no? Until the next time, thanks for watching. Cheers.